Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this discussion on the difficulty of equal justice, legal aid, and the criminal justice system. On behalf of Project 39A at National Law University, Delhi, I welcome all of you. And thank you to all the panelists for agreeing to be here from different parts of the country. The format that we're going to follow today, and I'm not going to go through a round of formal introductions. It's there, and I'm sure all of you are familiar with everyone's work here. The format that we're going to follow today is I have pre-circulated a bunch of issues that I'm likely to discuss and ask to the different panelists. So there will be no introductory comments or speeches, and I'll be directing questions to different panelists, and we'll do that for about an hour. And then we'll have questions from the audience for 30 minutes after that. That's the format. That's the format that they're not as much questions as they are an invitation to discuss. And in the sense, while I'll direct the question initially to one of you, please feel free to jump in and comment if you have anything to add or contradict or disagree. Disagreements would be great. I'll start with Justice Lokur and particularly with your work with the Supreme Court Legal Services Committee and the National Legal Service Authority, where in terms of legal aid in the criminal justice system, could you just start with flagging your main concerns with access, quality? How did you assess as an insider and also deciding the case in the 1382 prisons? How do you assess, as a former judge and with such vast experience, where do we stand today on such an important right in the criminal justice system? Yeah, it's working.
It's working? Yeah. Okay, yeah, thank you, Anup. There's only one point of disagreement. You know, when you said that, thank you for agreeing to come, when you make an invitation, there's no option but to accept it. No. Uh-huh. You are doing some wonderful work. And you need all the support that you can get. But coming to the Supreme Court Legal Services Committee, you know what I felt, and also I felt earlier when I was in charge of the Delhi High Court Legal Services Committee and the district, State Legal Services Committee in Delhi. What I felt was that, you know, the lawyers who are on the panel, they need to be committed to the cause. And in the Delhi High Court, we did have a program. We got some persons to come and talk to all the lawyers. We had a 2-day, 1.5-day program, sensitized them about legal aid, how to go about it, what should be done, what should not be done. And you know, that made a big difference. We also you know, very carefully selected the lawyers. It's not that if you're eligible to become a panel lawyer, then you automatically get appointed as a panel lawyer. I requested the judges in the Delhi High Court, 2 judges and 1 lawyer, to be on a panel and to select the lawyers. I did the same thing in the Supreme Court. I requested 2 judges and 1 lawyer to be there. So the selection, I think, made a big difference. Now, notwithstanding the fact that, you know, there was this screening process, so to speak, in the Supreme Court we had selected, or the committee had selected 40 lawyers, out of which I found that only 20 of them, no sorry, I think 80 lawyers were selected, out of which I found that 40 of them were having some interest in legal aid. We had a program for them also. And out of those 40, 20 of them were the ones who were really committed. Now, why I'm giving you this figure is that, you know, earlier what was happening is that people would come, they would say, we want to file an SLP against an order of conviction. And, you know, in, it would be processed in the routine manner. And, you know, maybe they would send a letter, maybe they would not send a letter. The onus was on the person who had come for legal aid to follow up his case, which meant that if the person was in custody, you know, following it up was not easy, number one. Number two, even if he was not in custody, because of his or her poverty, you know, it could not be easily followed up. So, you know, I requested the staff over there, and I also engaged four young lawyers on a payment basis to go through all the files that were there in the Supreme Court Legal Services Committee. There were about 4,000 files. And out of 4,000 files, it was found that about 1,700 of them had already been decided, you know, but nobody knew that they'd been decided. So that left 2,300. Out of 2,300, there were 700, that's about one third, cases where the SLP had not been filed. You know, and cases had not been filed, SLP had not been filed for about 14 years. You know, so if it's a case of life imprisonment, that person had already spent his life in jail. So what's the point of filing an SLP? So with the assistance of these four consultants, you know, we established contact with all these 700 people. And out of 700, 300 of them said that, you know, we are not interested in pursuing our case. Either we've served the sentence or we've engaged a private lawyer, you know, in somehow or the other. So that left really 400 cases. And these 400 cases then, we asked these 20 lawyers, we asked 40 lawyers to volunteer. Out of that, 20 of them volunteered and they filed all these cases. So one is, you know, commitment to the cause, namely that you want to give legal aid, not that you have to give legal aid because you're on the panel. You want to give it. The second is, you know, follow up on the case that comes to you from whomever it is. You know, don't, you can't expect that person to come and say that, listen, I want to know what's happening in my case. I think it's the duty of the legal aid authorities to tell that person. So we started using the video conferencing facility in the Supreme Court very frequently, almost on a daily basis, to even identify those who were in custody, you know, to find out what they needed. When I was in the Delhi High Court, we used to have a meeting. We used to have a meeting every Friday with, we had said about 20 people because the jail authority said we can handle about 20 people in a video conferencing room. And for the first 4 weeks, the only question that these prisoners asked was, what has happened to my case? So they did not know whether bail had been granted. They did not know whether the appeal had been admitted. They did not know whether the bail application had been dismissed. They had no knowledge. So there was no communication between the prisoner and the legal aid lawyer. You know, so these are, I think, issues which need to be thrashed out. Communication, in my view, is the most important thing. I mean, the guy is in custody. And if you don't tell him what's happening to his case, how is he going to find out? You know, so communication is very, very important. Follow-up is very, very important. We had a case of a young lady who had a child of maybe 1 or 2 years old. She was staying at one end of Delhi. Tihar jail was at the other end of Delhi. And there was no way that she came to us and she said, I can't go to Tihar jail. I don't have that kind of time. I don't have that kind of money. So we requested her to, you know, she wanted to have a video conference with her husband. We requested the jail that, you know, let this be a private conversation, and the jail authorities fortunately agreed. So communication at all points is very, very important. With this experience, I requested Anoop and his team to carry out some kind of a social audit to find out what's wrong with the Supreme Court Legal Services Committee. And they gave a wonderful report. Unfortunately, the report came maybe just about a week or so before you know, I demitted office as the chairperson of the SCLSC. I could not take any action on it. But that report is still pending. You know, there's now a subcommittee that has been appointed to look into the report.
And whether it should be made public.
So, you know, so this empathy or this compassion for persons who are in custody needs to be inculcated in the panel lawyers. Right? That, according to me, that's the only way this can succeed.
So, Monica, if I just bring you on that, Justice Lokur has identified sort of commitment to the cause, a lack of communication between the legal aid authorities and those who are beneficiaries of legal aid services, and that's seen at multiple levels. It's seen in the death penalty work that we've done, in the legal aid work that we're doing in Nagpur and Pune and Bombay. But this question of quality and the quality of assistance, do you think the problem is also deeper in terms of the nature of the legal profession itself? And is there something that speaks to this lack of commitment, which, I mean, there are clearly multiple aspects to this lack of commitment, but is there something about the very nature of legal profession in this country that's contributing to that problem?
Yeah, I do think that, you know, it's very individualized, our legal system. Also, the fact is that the quality of education itself, legal education itself is, you know, I mean, it's a varied or diverse quality. So because of that, I mean, the quality of even private lawyering is, you know, I mean, not of high caliber. So these are, so legal aid especially is really, I mean, the bottom of the pyramid. Yeah. So the people who are, and it's not even bottom of the pyramid, I mean, the CHRI study shows that only 4% of lawyers actually are legal aid lawyers. So it, the fact is that you not only have a very small number, but you also have a, not a very good, not the best of lawyers are really. So quality of legal aid itself is reflective of the kind of quality of lawyering which is present. And the fact is that I think there are two things here when we talk about quality of lawyering and quality of legal aid. One is that, you know, civil law itself, and it's not just to do with the quality of lawyering, it's also to do with the quality of justice, of the justice system. And we've seen that in India, basically, the legal system itself has evolved as rule of criminal law rather than as rule of law. And the civil law, I think the, you know, we all know the backlogs and things like that. So because of that, civil law itself, most of the people, at some level, engagement with civil law in the courts is much lower than engagement with criminal law, partly because the number of laws we have, majority of them are criminal laws, and we visualize rights as mainly criminalization rather than as giving of civil rights. So at one level, there is a certain collapse of civil law systems, and legal aid doesn't even address that. But what legal aid is forced to address is you know, legal aid for those who are incarcerated or engaged in the criminal legal system. So most of the people who actually engage with civil law are people who are who can engage with the legal system. They're not really people who, if I have the means, can I actually engage with the legal system. So legal aid doesn't even address that issue. What legal aid is forced to address is the issue of criminalization, and we all know that criminalization, actually, who gets criminalized? So it's majority of the people who get criminalized are poor. Neither can they afford private lawyering, nor can they afford high quality private lawyering. So at one level, the best quality of lawyers also actually gets diverted into the civil legal system, where there is money. So the criminal legal system, the quality services in the criminal legal system actually go to those who can afford that. And there are very few people who can actually afford quality legal services within the criminal justice system. And so they are the ones who are actually forced into legal aid. But even those who actually, and this has been my experience working, and not just over here in Nagpur and Pune, but also my experience as a lawyer has been that even the quality of private lawyering is really, you know, as Sir rightly pointed out, it's not just about legal aid, but it's also about what kind of quality of legal aid.
Yeah. Vijay, in terms of how prisoners and under trial prisoners perceive this idea of legal aid, the sense seems to be that there is a lot of distrust, a lot of reluctance ki hame kuch bhi ho sarkari vakil nahi chahiye, we will drive ourselves into debt, and in that context, I would like you to first reflect on your own with your vast experience, what are the dimensions of this distrust and why is there that distrust, and is there even any hope of overcoming this distrust? Because one of the things that we found in the SALSE audit was that the problem is not that too many cases are coming, is that there's an underutilization of legal aid, massive underutilization of legal aid services. What do we do about it? And what has given rise to this situation?
Yeah. Okay, I'd just like to kind of first add a little bit to this conversation that has happened. And I have a question to put before all of us, is that, is legal aid an essential service or not? And unless we squarely answer that question, I don't think we can we leave something like legal aid to like commitment? With due apologies to you, sir, that, you know, that if we need committed lawyers, you know, well, if it is a right and if it has to be given of a certain quality, why is it that for so many years, decades and decades, we are still paying, in Maharashtra, we are paying 750 rupees per effective hearing for a legal aid lawyer to appear in court, and for non-effective hearing, 500 rupees. How are you going to expect, you know, lawyers of certain quality to come and, I believe the system is far better in Delhi, because I'm also told that lawyer, DLSA lawyers, they get up to 50,000 rupees in cases. In Maharashtra, the highest amount is 7,500 rupees. They can't get more than 7,500, irrespective of the number of hearings. And this is after it has been improved 2 years back, where earlier it was 1,200 rupees for an entire trial at the lower court, and at the sessions court, 1,800 rupees. So my first question, that if you are really serious about legal aid, we can't leave it to, you know, committed lawyers. If committed lawyers will be there, that'll be great. I mean, there's no question about it. But we have to raise the standard, and the only way to raise the standard is to ensure that we pay them well, so that then we can demand a certain kind of accountability from them. Why can't we have a system like, you, if you have prosecution lawyers on a salaried basis, why can't you have defense lawyers on a salaried basis from the legal aid system? But somehow all of us are reluctant to do this, and that really reveals the nature of the criminal justice system, that it is biased against the poor, and poor are supposed to defend and fend for themselves.
Or does it reflect a bias that we don't like people who commit crimes, and therefore it's not worth investing.
True. And coming to your other question of, you know, what do prisoners think of this legal aid lawyers? It's very true that they look at Sarkari Vakil as somebody who will lead him to conviction or her to conviction. So there is a reluctance to, you know, मतलब मैं बिना वकील के रह जाऊँगा लेकिन मुझे सरकारी वकील नहीं चाहिए. It's through our work that in the last 9 months, you know, where through this project where we are all working together, with continuous follow-up with the legal aid lawyers from our side by the fellows who have been appointed, we just recently had a meeting to discuss and take stock of work, and the answer was that roughly about 50% of the legal aid lawyers are in touch with their clients. That means if the accused, the under trial, sees the lawyer in court, he is likely to recognize him. That's about 50%. Yeah. And roughly about 30% are doing effective work. And this is after persistent follow-up with the lawyers from our end in terms of phone calls and asking them to be present in court, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm coming back to the same question, that if we pay peanuts, we'll get peanuts.
I think clearly there's a narrative, and a much more familiar narrative, from the prisoner's accused side to this, right? And but what does it look like from the victim's perspective, right? The question of what should legal aid for victims comprise? Is it just about assistance in appearing in court? Or does the legal aid system have a much broader mandate on that? Should it have a much broader mandate as well on rehabilitation and other related issues? Yeah.
I think I just want to very quickly just add to what Professor Raghavan was saying, that this is a huge problem. There are several matters that have been allotted by the Karnataka Legal Service Authority to panel lawyers and have subsequently come to our office because of repeated non-representation, dismissal for non-prosecution. Sometimes what we would consider fairly ordinary things like 125 maintenance applications in family courts and, you know, things like that. So whether we start very hard to think about an application, the Legal Service Authority in Karnataka very recently made a call for applications to be appointed to be a panel lawyer, and I was thinking I should put one in. And I picked up the phone and I spoke to four friends who have been appointed as panel lawyers, whom you would actually go to even otherwise. It's not, they're very, very competent trial counsels. And they've been on the panel for the last 4 years, and not a single case has been allotted to them. And they have absolutely no idea why. So the process of why, how do you, because if you've put in an application, they've said yes, then you're, and you, in your mind, you're saying, yes, I'm putting aside this much of my time and energy or whatever it is to do these particular types of cases. So they said, whether you put in an application or not makes no difference. Anyway, you're doing the work. So why do you want to jump through the hoops of sending an application, etc.? It'll come to you. Anyway, that's part of the work that you do. So this is a very serious thing, whether just an application to be appointed in a panel, as Justice Lokur was also pointing out, is sufficient. That being the case, how much actual legal aid work can a single lawyer actually do? Because if you're being paid 750 rupees or 800 or 1,000 rupees for effective and 800 for non-effective hearing, as a private counsel whose money comes from elsewhere, I'm not actually interested in that money because it doesn't, I'm doing the case not for the 800 rupees, yeah. Right? So this question of how is it then do you get that quality of lawyer, and with that payment or with, I agree that a financial incentive may be one of the things that may up the quality of the lawyer who is assigned to a legal, but I don't think that's all there is. I actually think that it's the legal aid cases are really difficult cases to do for several reasons. A lot of times they come to you having gone through other lawyers, and you then spend a significant amount of time trying to undo several things that you believe ought not to have gone down the way they have, and then bring a case back on track. If it's a criminal trial matter, then your hands get tied if a lawyer has taken a particular line of defense, some witnesses have been cross-examined, not cross-examined, and then that matter lands on your plate, and a judge is saying, I'm not going to permit you to recall some 8 witnesses because you feel that the earlier counsel has not done a good enough job of. So it's really, it's the quality of it. And that I do not, I'm not quite sure how one assesses that. How does one actually assess that at a district level? I suppose it would be easier to do at the High Court and Supreme Court level because you're talking about a particular type of case. It's a criminal appeal or an SLP. But a trial is an entirely different matter. And a trial is the first point of adjudication of rights, whether of victim or accused. By the time you reach that stage of appeal, several things have happened. There can be a conviction, which is obviously by a trial court. Now, what is the quality of that defense that has been taken in that criminal trial? So we spend a lot of time, I think, thinking about the of the High Court or the Supreme Court level, and we grossly ignore what happens in a magistrate's court and in a sessions court. Also, what happens in a civil court, very rightly, as Monica said, that you don't get too many. But a lot of times in family court, a lot of the ordinary maintenance applications under 125 are filed through legal aid lawyers, where there is zero follow-up. That lawyer is not checking whether process has been paid, other side has been served, arguments, nothing. So, I mean, the for me, the concern as a practicing counsel is certainly at the level of first point of adjudication, which is at the trial court. And that is, if you don't get it right at that level in terms of competent, effective representation, by the time you reach that High Court and Supreme Court level, those lawyers are going to have a much harder task of what they have because several things have been decided. Now, when you're coming to your question on victims and accused, I actually believe these need to be two very different systems. Because what is expected of you as a criminal, as a defense lawyer, is very, very different and cannot, your mind essentially cannot be clouded at all by what has happened to a victim in that matter. Your job in that case is very distinct. So when you look at victims and whether legal aid, the system of legal aid to victims, assisting victims in what they are going to go through while giving evidence, whether you're looking at children as special victims or you're looking at acid attack victims, or even if you're looking at families where a family member has been murdered, etc., and they're coming to give evidence, a lot of that is psychological. And also what to expect that a defense lawyer is going to do to them while standing in that witness box. And that defense lawyer, whether legal aid or not, has a job to do. And that job has to be done. That is where that is the purpose and role of that lawyer. So these are two very, very different systems. I don't think that they can be collapsed necessarily because the kind of assistance that you need to give to victims is very different from what happens when you're looking at an accused. The accused is essentially facing the might of the state in terms of a very big investigation that could have been mounted and therefore resulting in a charge sheet and etc. A victim is like a collateral system in that. So what you are doing while granting victims assistance, whether you're looking at victim compensation schemes, etc., is trying to alleviate the difficulty and the trauma of what they will face when they're witnesses for the prosecution. So how do you then reconcile these two roles? And therefore, they necessarily need to be two different systems because you can't have them both collapsed into one. And I think this is the difficulty in the current situation because it's the same legal services authority that is appointing the panel lawyers on both sides. Mm. Now, the skills that are required to be on either side and to know what is, it's like to anticipate what the other side, how do you face a cross-examination, all these things, to hold, it's like hand-holding them through that. So I believe they're two entirely, they should be two entirely.
Actually, in Maharashtra, my experience has been that when victims go to DLSA to get legal aid, because one of the things that has actually been pushed over the years has been this ADR business, so the alternate dispute redressal mechanism. So Maharashtra has really taken on mediation as a major pet project. And most of the victims actually are diverted to mediation and to ADRs. Mm. So that is, so actually they're dealing with it differently. So and the other thing is that unless you're a woman or an SEST or something that you can easily avail legal aid if you're not, so if you're an under trial, you're automatically entitled to legal aid. Otherwise, you have an income criteria. So then you have to show an income certificate. So those are the other barriers to victims getting legal aid here.
Arti, if I may just push you a little bit on what something Justice Lokur said in terms of how do we select lawyers, right? And I think this point that you made of why do some lawyers get more cases from the legal aid system? Like in the Supreme Court, there's one lawyer who is very, seems to be getting all the death penalty cases for some reason and doing them terribly. But anyway, but in terms of your own experience in Bangalore, this training aspect, both in terms of that certain cases require assistance way beyond the legal, and that even as a criminal defense lawyer, that is there a continuous training, updating of skills, knowledge? Again, I come back to the question, is there a problem with just the legal aid system, or is it generally a problem with the bar that you see that that skill level, that continuous legal education as just as a concept has just seemed to have bypassed as a professional requirement?
I think it's not easy to make a living as a lawyer, actually. I mean, I can if you, and this is evident in so many ways. If you were to spend a week in the magistrate's court in Bangalore, you'll see people who are enrolled as lawyers struggling to make a living. Right. Now, the fact is that we're churning out though thousands of lawyers. If you look at between all the national law schools and the I was just coming to that, Professor Raghavan. I was just about to say that. So if you were to just look at the numbers that are there, and then you look at, and I'm not speaking of just the NLUs. There are several other smaller law colleges. Mine is from a three-year law college that's was affiliated to Bangalore University. There are thousands of lawyers, and you'll see those numbers teeming in magistrates' court and in sessions courts and in family courts, which makes you think that obviously there is something. Yeah. You think that there's something going on here, that, but it's very hard to make a living. If you were to, and I really think this is a study that really ought to be done. If you were to pick a lawyer who has somewhere between, say, 4 to 7 years and say under 10 or 12 years of experience, and you were to look at how they earn a living, what they make a living from, right? What are the skills that they are deploying in order to make that living? You will realize that there is very little lawyering in that, right? There is a lot of affidavit making type activities. I don't know how else to phrase it, but those are really the things that are making them that 400, 500, 600 rupees a day, right? Now, on top of this, there is absolutely no check of quality of what makes us lawyers. I mean, does someone not need to check whether we're still good enough to be lawyers 10 years, 12 years, 15 years into the profession?
Yeah.
I can understand that at some point you may want to, if you've been doing this for 20 years, then but until that you reach that point, is there no standard that we need to aspire to be? Now they put in place this bar council exam, which, I mean, it wasn't there when I enrolled at the bar, but I was like, my God, why would you do this? You may as well not do it, because I have not heard of a single person has failed the bar exam.
It has
like nobody has failed it.
It's about 99% clearance rate.
Yeah, some 99.8 or something, which makes me think, okay, then, you know, maybe we are really, we've missed something. We've missed something in terms of how we train lawyers to do what they do.
Yeah.
And there is absolutely no subsequent then refresher training, etc., that is expected of us.
Yeah.
And then on top of this, you're also asking us to be effective legal aid counsel. So it's really, I mean, the system is just completely unfair from too many angles,
right?
I mean, you can't be all of these things.
Right.
Unless you're being educated really well, and then there is a constant standard that you need to aspire to be, to continue to do right. what it is.
And therefore to think about, is it money plus?
I think there's no question of removing that question of commitment. To the extent that you, it can only be a committed individual who will do quality legal aid work. Because the challenges in what come in a legal aid case, given the fact that you don't make any money from it, requires you to then do something extraordinary to deliver for that right. client in that particularly difficult situation.
Right.
So it's a commitment. How you will evaluate that commitment is the question.
Right. Right.
What is it that evaluates? Is there a standard that one can actually put in place that
yes.
evaluates that? In which case, then you'll have a much higher standard. For example, I was told that in Delhi, public prosecutors who, with the AAP government, that public prosecutors in the high courts appearing are paid significantly higher than public prosecutors anywhere else. And the standard of lawyering from the state side has gotten much better, which is very interesting, I find, because the state then is actually doing something with respect to its own case in criminal matters.
Yeah. Just Lokur, in terms of just this conversation about quality, monitoring, I think one of the things that we found when we were in charge of the SALSC was the SALSC knew when the case came, the SALSC knew when the case was allocated to a panel lawyer. The next time the SALSC knew anything about the case was only if and when the lawyer claimed the fees. And in between, the SALSC just had no clue of was the SLP filed, was there hearings, how many adjournments, right? Should, in your experience, has there been any effort at training lawyers in terms of their competence? What can legal aid authorities do anything, or is there something in the very design and structure of legal aid authorities that prevent them from playing this kind of role that Aarti is talking about, that they themselves are not positioned to do this kind of training?
Yeah, by the authorities, I take it you mean the person who's in charge of the legal aid center. Yeah, you know, there are two things. One is, you know, the commitment aspect. Is legal aid about money? You know, I think that is one question that needs to be asked. If you're getting paid 750 rupees in Bombay, have I asked you to become a legal aid lawyer? You have volunteered to become a legal aid lawyer. You knew it's going to be 750 rupees. Who the hell forced you to become a legal aid lawyer? Don't become a legal aid lawyer. You know, unless you're interested. The payment, the money aspect is separate. The money aspect is completely separate. I'm not saying that 750 is good enough. I'm not saying that. Surely they should be paid. But don't crib if you're not getting paid what you think you should be paid. You know? It's okay, Delhi has got a lot of money, they're paying good amount, that's okay. But even Delhi lawyers say that, listen, 50,000 is nothing, yeah, why not 1 lakh? You know? No, there's no end to this. Yeah, so I think you cannot, it's my opinion, you cannot wash out commitment. You cannot say that, you know, just because I'm getting 1 lakh rupees, therefore I'm very highly committed. No, it doesn't work that way. You have lawyers who are getting 1 lakh rupees are still not committed. So don't underestimate commitment. You know, money is there, but I would place it as secondary. Now, you know, about the legal aid people giving training and so on and so forth. Like I said, in the Delhi High Court, when I was in charge, we got lawyers to conduct a 1.5 day program, right? And those lawyers, and some of them have become judges, some other lawyers whom they have trained, they are conducting 1.5 day programs, you know, from time to time, whenever there's a change in the panel or something, and there are sufficient number of lawyers, they conduct a program. They're doing it free. Okay, so it's not that the authorities have to take the initiative. The authorities can take the initiative and say, listen, I don't know how to train, but I know this person who can train. let me call him and let him train. There's nothing to stop them from doing it.
So the question I ask is, just as we haven't paid enough attention to the specialization of judicial education, right? That's another conversation altogether. And there's a certain specialization to how to educate judges. Similarly, is there a specialization to continuing legal education that the model of relying on the goodwill of a few senior lawyers is untenable and is not what is actually required to deliver competence and commitment? I mean, that's in terms of, do we need more specialization, just as we constantly say we need more specialization in judicial education?
Specialization in legal aid? Legal aid work?
Yeah, in terms of, yeah. Yeah,
I don't know, it's very difficult to answer, because, when you are talking about judicial education, you're talking about all the judges.
Correct.
Right? So you have judicial academies all over.
Correct.
Now, you're talking about a limited number of judges. You're talking about 16, 17,000 and 25 judicial academies or more.
Yeah.
So it's manageable. But when you're talking about, I don't know what the figure is, but it was last at about 16, 17 lakh lawyers. How are you going to train 16, 17 lakh lawyers? Where is the wherewithal? Is there any establishment, that has been set up by the Bar Council of India or by the State Bar Council? So you really can't train that large number of lawyers. But efforts have been made, not necessarily with regard to legal aid. I know, as a matter of fact, efforts have been made, at least in the three high courts that I was there, in Delhi, in Guwahati, and in Andhra Pradesh, undivided Andhra Pradesh, that the lawyers conducted programs on their own. So they would say that, we're conducting a program. Do you want to come? So if somebody wants to come, they will come. But again, I know that in the Delhi High Court, it kind of petered out, right? In the Guwahati High Court, it petered out. I don't know about Andhra, but I'm sure it must have petered out. So this sort of, continuing legal education to lawyers has to come from within the legal
fraternity,
from the legal community or the community of lawyers, from the Bar Council, from the Bar Associations, State Bar Council, Bar Council of India.
Monica, is it leaving too much to chance? I mean, in the sense that generally might be true of many of our institutional mechanisms and systems, that are we leaving too much to chance that we expect Justice Lokurs to man the legal aid systems? And in that sense, and that's leading to my question of, we find so few judges actually committed an understanding of legal aid and how it should be and what it should be. Should legal aid be headed by judicial officers or judges? And you see that the whole structure is such. And in the sort of push that conversation about specialization, does it do more harm than good to have judges head these, head the architecture of legal aid authorities in the district and the state and the Supreme Court?
I think yes and no. At one level, because judges hold a certain kind of position of power, they're able to kind of, maneuver more visibility and more resources and more people come forward and do things. So at that level, yes, it makes sense to have them. But on the other hand, they don't really see that as their primary responsibility. So, it really varies on how committed a judge is, as your question rightly said, that it depends on that. The second thing is, because it's rotational, so it there's no continuity of commitment, there's no continuity of any kind. So that is one thing, but I think it goes deeper than that, in the sense that even if there was an institution which actually headed it, how would you imagine the system is really what would you know, constitute a real change. For me, the fundamental question is that really, you know, if you're going to have a legal aid system which is functioning the way or structured the way it is structured, and even if it was institutionalized that it had committed personnel, manning it or as resources, how many lawyers would, and even if you had, you know, better payment, ultimately, you know, if I'm a lawyer, most of the lawyers who join legal aid and start doing any kind of legal aid practice are doing it in the initial stages of their career. And those who are experienced and are wanting to do something, very few like her would want to do something because of a sense of commitment. But most of them actually are looking at a new area of practice that they want to establish themselves in. So they nobody wants to be the best legal aid lawyer in the country. Everybody wants to be the best criminal lawyer, the highest paid lawyer. So those are the ambitions that people have, you know. So unless you actually have a system of dedicated people, like how you have in the prosecution system, you have a system of dedicated people, then, you know, the question that the debate between Vijay and Justice Lokur would make sense, that why would I join the legal aid system? I'm not joining it because I'm committed. I'm joining because I want a foothold in that court. I want visibility. I want matters. And then it also, you know, I mean, we all know it's an open secret that I also get money on the side. So it's, I'm not really concerned about that 600, 700. I know that I'll tell my client that you have to pay me 5,000 rupees, and he knows that a private lawyer will charge him more than that. So at that level, unless we have people who are actually dedicated into the system and the structure is visualized as actually having people who are going to be, the lawyers have to be long-term and have to be committed. That is what, according to me.
Yeah, sir.
Just answering the first part of your question, I've seen the system when it was not in the hands of the judiciary. And believe me, it was much worse. Because it was then under the Law and Judiciary Department.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And then after NALSA came in, you know, then the state legal services authorities were set up. And there is a far greater seriousness today to the matter of legal aid than what it was when it was in the hands of the executive.
Yeah. Yeah.
So at least, I mean, I can only say on the basis of Maharashtra experience that, you know, it's better that it's in the hands of the judiciary. That's one part. The other small point is that one also needs to look at the infrastructure that is available to the DLSAs. And unless one addresses that issue, you know, you have a full-time secretary, but what kind of staff do they have? Usually one or two people who are there. And we have also seen in the taluka places, there's not even one dedicated staff for handling legal aid matters.
But Vijay, how do you square that with the position that one of the complaints that you don't hear from NALSA or the SLSAs, as let's say compared to a global context where budgets for legal aid are being cut, right? That doesn't seem to be a concern in terms of lack of funds. But it might be on what are they spending?
No. They may have funds for, you know, awareness programs. They may have funds.
Yeah.
But this is, you know, you need to have full-time salaried people working as a clerk or as a superintendent or as an officer who has to do the job of allocation of lawyers, who has to look at the roster. You know, all of that requires a lot of time and, you know, systematic work.
Yeah.
Now, if the same person is handling two, three jobs...
Yeah.
You know, so like in one taluka, we found that that person sits only once a month and then looks at all the cases that are pending and then just randomly allots legal aid lawyers in that case.
So Aarti and Justice Lokur, if I could just have quick responses on this idea of a dedicated defense service, right? Or whatever, like you have a prosecution service.
As compared to this panel.
Yeah, as this kind of, what are your views on that? If you could just quickly have, are you in favor of it, or are you skeptical? Are you thinking it's impractical? What?
Yeah, you know, it's like this. I believe that a legal aid center, you know, whether it's the state legal services authority or taluka or district, has to be run like a lawyer's office. It has to be a professional body. Okay, And in that professional body, you have one person who's in charge. It could be the member secretary. He needs a steno. You know, he needs clerks. He needs all these, you know, paraphernalia, whatever it is. You have 20 lawyers. It's a large lawyer's office, so you have 20 lawyers or 30 lawyers. They need to be, you know, looked after in the sense of, you know, facilities and so on and so forth, staff. If I want to dictate a bail application, I don't have to go running around, you know. Now, how does a prosecutor's office work? A prosecutor's office works more or less not as professionally as a lawyer's office, but the paraphernalia is there,
right?
You know, so all that you need to do is you need to strengthen the legal aid office into a lawyer's office, right? And this is what I told the SCLSC people, that you know, you are no better and no worse than a lawyer's office, because a client is coming to you. He says, I want legal aid, you know. Give it to him. See if he's eligible for legal aid. Of course, that's because of the statute. But if he's eligible for legal aid, give it to him. And give it to him as you would in any lawyer's office.
Right. Yeah.
Now, if you do that, you know, then you don't need a, you know, public defender system.
Right.
You can call this also a public defender system. It's only a question of words, you know. So that mindset has to change.
Right.
Just one thing that she said, you know, about that rotational thing, it's very, very important at the High Court level, also at the Supreme Court level. Because I'm number two, therefore I'm in charge of state.
Correct.
I'm number three, therefore I'm in charge of district. Maybe I'm not interested.
Yeah.
You know, so why don't you have somebody who's junior, you know, a junior judge who is more interested in legal aid, put him in charge of that. You see, you have a library committee. Okay, I don't become member of the library committee or chairman of the library committee because I'm so senior. You know, I may be a junior judge. The Chief Justice may put me over there. Why should that distinction be made? So, you know, what she's saying is correct, absolutely correct. Let's get rid of this, you know, seniority business. Because I'm senior, therefore I should be over here. It doesn't work like that.
Right. Arthi?
This Lokur's model would be a dream. I would be very happy to
participant of that system.
I work in that system.
Right.
I would absolutely work in that system.
Right.
It's just that you know, the fact of the matter is that the infrastructure and the effort that goes into doing a case is the same, irrespective of whether someone is paying you 3 lakh rupees for a case or whether your legal services authority is paying you 700 rupees. It's the same effort that goes into a bail application. It's the same effort to argue it. It's the same effort. The question is whether you have supporting infrastructure that is built around you being able to be effective in that system. So if whether you call it a public defender's office or whether you call it a legal aid office, its accessibility in terms of where it is located and how efficiently someone who walks in is diverted to a lawyer who can address this question and do it well and effectively, and the volume of how much will come in. It's something that it's an experiment. One will have to try and see whether something of this nature works as effectively as a salaried
service. So if I may just shift track, Vijay, and sort of bring you in on a lot of this conversation on legal aid and criminal justice system is centered around reducing overcrowding of prisons, right? And when overcrowding of prisons is talked about, it's spoken more or less in the context of under trials, right? You've been a part of many initiatives by the courts, by governments, there have been legislative amendments trying to solve this whole problem, right? And clearly it's, maybe some of it has worked, some of it hasn't, but could you just speak to what are we doing right, what are we not doing right, what is our approach to reducing under-trial prisoners that needs radical reimagination, if at all? Yeah.
I don't know if it's radical or not, but I think our problem starts with the fact that we treat imprisonment as a one-stop solution to all forms of deviance offenses. I mean, we are reaching a point where if people, we're going to soon have a law that, you know, if plastic is being thrown, then they'll also go to jail. Yeah. So for everything, the only solution is send them to jail. Yeah. So that's one thing that we have not explored alternatives to imprisonment at all. And whatever laws that we have, which talk about alternatives to imprisonment, we have completely ignored them. And the prime example of that is the Neglect of the Probation of Offenders Act, which is a law which could have been used more creatively. And I think a large percentage of people who are in prison as under trials may have been out if they were...
Could you just capture for the audience what the act is about?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So this is a law which was passed in 1958. It's called the Probation of Offenders Act, under which if you are not convicted in an offense which... where the maximum sentence does not amount to life sentence or death. In all other offenses, instead of sending you to prison, you could be sent back to the community, either on a bond of good behavior or with supervision by a probation officer. And there's a process to it, that there is a probation officer who is supposed to file a social inquiry report. And based on the social inquiry report, the magistrate or the judge can take a decision whether this person is a fit case to be released back in the community. The magistrate can also impose additional conditions. And this is where, you know, when we keep talking about community service, we don't necessarily need another law on community service. Within the Probation of Offenders Act, there is a provision that the magistrate may impose any other condition as he may deem fit. Under that, he could include community service. You know? He could ask the... there are provisions under which where... the magistrate can appoint a part-time probation officer. Just somebody, he finds this person to be a responsible person, he can say, okay, for this case, you are the probation officer. Mm. So it doesn't even, there is a provision in the rules for having voluntary probation officers, where they don't have to be full-time paid government employees. But right through the country, you find that this law has been systematically neglected. Right. And so that's one, so basically the point was alternatives to imprisonment. The second is whatever changes have come out, you know, your Section 41D CRPC, where arrest is not mandatory, but you see that it continues to be arrest is mandatory. And the third is, when are we going to re-examine our financial system of bail?
Yeah.
That's the only way when it comes to bail, that there are other possibilities, that there are countries who have tried other options. I mean, our complete lack of faith in looking at personal bond as a way out. I mean, yes, magistrates are worried that if I release somebody on personal bond, he or she may abscond. So is there a way to find out, okay, like, can a social inquiry report be filed? You know, can there be a risk assessment process be done? We are not experimenting. I mean, we need to experiment. We'll make mistakes. Learn from that process. But as long as we say that this is the only way forward, I really don't see how this problem of overcrowding is going to, because the other solution is to keep building more and more jails, which is also not going to be...
I just want to very quickly just add two things. One is that the assumption in your question, Anoop, is that we want to actually reduce under-trial populations. Now, no, one second. This depends on the state that you're looking at very specifically. So if you look at states like Jharkhand, if you look at places like Chhattisgarh, it is actually the state that wants to ensure that a large population is in prison.
Processes.
And the processes that ensure that they are kept there is the minute bail is granted, after it comes, several other cases being put on the same accused, them being transported from, this is very, actually it's really common. It's not something that, so I'm not entirely convinced that there is actually some significant political or otherwise will to keep under trials out. That question would vary from the law and order situation and the specific problems that the state is addressing vis-a-vis all other types of issues. Mm. So in so that's one thing, and I don't think that it can be like a broad kind of right. answer. That's one. Mm. Two, I mean, this thing of conditions of bail is actually, I mean, it's actually quite heart-wrenching. We've had several cases where actually bail has been granted, but we have just not been able to furnish compliance. Conditions.
Yeah.
And we're talking about under trials who are, you know, like, who is going to stand bail for an Assamese security guard worker who has been accused of murder in Bangalore? Which person is going to come forward to say, I will stand as surety? Yeah. Right? So this is, I mean, it happens too frequently. And of course, it happens only to a particular class of worker, migrant worker, etc. And when it comes to women under trials, I think it's even harder because at some point of time, families fatigue of mounting a significant defense.
Right.
And if they are convicted, then even less so for further appeals, etc. Because you've spent money on a trial that has gone on for 5, 6, 7 odd years, yeah. and you're now faced with a conviction for life. Who is going to pump in that money to file an appeal, prosecute an appeal? Well, even if so, the travesty is actually when it ends in an acquittal 11, 12 years after that conviction. So yeah. someone has actually spent all the trial period in custody because you've got bail, unable to furnish, or not got bail, which can also happen if it's a UAPA offense or you know something of that nature. And then has started serving sentence after conviction only to be acquitted by a high court 8 years later because the high court is dealing with hearing appeals today in Karnataka, criminal appeals being heard by a division bench. There are two benches currently. Final hearings are of the year 2009, 10, 11. We're in 2019. So by an appeal that I have filed today will probably be heard.
2020.
And if someone is acquitted. So you see, I mean, how do you tell someone? It's also very hard for a lawyer to justify right, this when you go to right. when you go right. and you say suspension of sentence and bail has been rejected. Now your it'll come up in due course, and we will now just wait. How? What do you say to a? It's very hard.
It's almost like the system is saying we can't secure convictions, so we just want to keep you there as long as we can, right? And in that sense. Monica, before I frame the constitutional question for Justice Lokur, I just this experience that we've seen in the program that we've been doing in Bombay, Nagpur, and Pune, an institutional push to plead guilty,
yeah.
right? That legal aid authorities and state governments and prisons all seem to be enthusiastic about drives to plead guilty. And in a way, reduce prison population, right? And reduce prison population, right? One can sense the perversity of it, but if you could just comment on the perversity of it, yeah.
Actually, you know, I find this whole overcrowding question also very, very dubious.
Right.
Because actually, I don't know how accurate prison statistics are, but they are the government's own figures. So they actually talk about 118%. You know, the as per capacity is 100% and the population is 118%, which is not really as over the way one would imagine overcrowding to be, you know.
Yeah.
One would think overcrowding means 3 times, 4
yeah.
times the amount.
Yeah.
But it's actually 20% over.
Yeah.
The question is really that 67.5% of the population is under trial. And majority of them are, you know, I was going through the prison statistics as I was sharing with you earlier. What I found very interesting is that when we look at the convict population, which is around 20 odd percent, then there's a sizable amount of murder accused in that, you know. So the murder accused, if you look at the under trial murder accused population and you look at the convict murder accused population, the convict murder accused population is higher than the under trial murder accused population. That means like if there are some 30,000 under trial murder accused, there are 33,000 convict murder accused. That means murder, if you've committed a murder, there's a high chance of you getting out on bail. And then you may get convicted later, even though bail conditions are so far more stringent when it comes to murder. But if we look at theft cases, which is punishable with maximum imprisonment of 3 years, and that means maximum, you know. I mean, murder, at least you have life imprisonment as mandatory, or murder. So you can't have less than that. But this is maximum imprisonment of 3 years. You have around 30% of the under trial population are in for theft, whereas the convict population is 10%. So 10% of the 27% are actually convict, have been convicted for for theft. But I feel that one of the major, you know, this whole drives are not really for emptying out prisons, but the rhetoric is of that. Because that's how I actually tell somebody, because what this figure actually tells you is that if there are 30, if there's an X, 3 times the number of people who are actually going to get convicted and are in jail prior to their trial, and because they're not able to even get that measly amount of bail that otherwise they would have been entitled to, the system is really telling them that if you want to get out, now it's too bad, you can't avail bail. So at least plead guilty and we'll let you off. But the actual purpose of getting them to plead guilty is not really to empty out the jail. It is actually to step up your conviction rate.
Right.
So that is it. And the other thing is, there's an assumption that if poor people are in jail, then they must have done something, especially theft. So no rich person is going to be in for theft, you know. So the ideology behind it is that definitely this person must have done it. Like in Bombay, we had this meeting during the as a part of this project, and we met a retired High Court judge, and he said, "Now this person is not going to get a government job. So what difference does it make?" So the justification for it is it's almost cold-hearted. And so that is one of the things that the plead guilty campaign is, that this is the only way we can actually help people. That is the ostensible, the overt rhetoric. Right. But the actual
motivation
is really to actually gear up the...
Yeah, sure.
Just to also kind of add to what she's saying, that, you know, this whole category of summary trial offenses, how can you have two types of justice system within the law? The one where, you know, you don't have any process of, you know, pleading innocence and then a trial going on. So that means if it is for the lowest type of offenses, where there will be no due process. So it's kind of adding to what, it's already there in the law. Yeah, and the large numbers of people who are brought in the morning court, they just ask, guna kabul hai ki nahi? If they say kabul hai, then they get 7 days. If they say kabul nahi hai, they get 10 days.
Right.
Yeah. So that's it. The matter ends there. You know. So this whole thing of guna kabul, some of these jail courts are known as guna kabul courts. Yeah. Yeah. They are told that ye guna kabul karna hai, to ye naam likhao. Or fir us din magistrate will come and that whole thing will...
Or the railway courts or whatever.
Yeah, railway courts.
We also convince juveniles to plead guilty routinely.
Yeah.
Right? Because, I mean, it saves a lot of trial time. Can you... And it's because it's a magistrate who sits on the juvenile board. So that one day or 2 days a week that the magistrate is serving, separate charge sheet has to be filed. Prosecutor has to be appointed in that court, go through an entire trial. Instead of that, just plead guilty and then we'll give you whatever, that minimum. Anyway, there's very little that we can do.
So there are also very, very many
juvenile
calculations also here.
Yes.
There are the more experienced under trials,
who will
quote
tell
unquote,
you?
Who will tell you, kaun se case mein aaya hai, kitna property ka kitna value hai, to itne mahine ke baad guna kabul kar
le. Exactly.
And
so
it's
it'll
pretty
be set
true.
Off.
Yes. He'll get a set off.
Good statistical analysis.
Yeah, statistical.
A lot more better than the NCRB. Right. So if Just Loku, if I may bring you back to a rather provocative question that Vijay posed in terms of how committed are we to the legal aid question? And in that terms, the constitutional position, in terms of all the context of the criminal justice system that all of you have spoken about, is that the pretrial system, the position of legal aid as a fundamental right under Part 3, is rather weak, is a rather dodgy right, right? It seems to be a strong right the moment you move into the trial phase, right? But at the pre-trial phase, particularly at the stage of police custody, there seems to be this constitutional silence of whether you're entitled to free legal aid. I mean, not constitutional, it's sort of pretty obvious. They've explicitly stated that you don't have it, right? That you're, you can stick to Article 22, Clause 1. You have, is the system somewhere saying that we want to pay lip service, but we really can't afford to ensure that everyone who's arrested by the police and is taken into police custody must have a free legal aid lawyer? Yes, of course, there are schemes of NALSA and the state legal service authorities or the district legal service authorities that give you, it's set up through a scheme, but the absence of its recognition as a fundamental right, does it speak to some of this conversation that the system is somehow designed to ensure that the process is the punishment?
Yeah, I think in some ways. But, you know, I think we are also to be blamed for it. You know, sometimes you get overwhelmed. Oh my God, you know, there are 3 crore cases pending. How are we going to solve the problem? There's no way I can solve the problem, so therefore forget it. You know, why should I waste my time? So how am I going to give legal aid to a person at the pre-trial stage, you know, when he's arrested or something? It's impossible, so why should I waste my time? You know, so it's really a problem of, you know, management and implementation of the schemes and the laws, right? You have, if I remember correctly, something like 67,000 or 63,000 legal aid lawyers all over the country. You have another 63 or 67,000 paralegal volunteers all over the country. So you're talking about something like 1,30,000 persons who are empaneled to give that assistance. Are they doing their job? You know, is somebody trying to find out whether they're doing their job or not? Whose responsibility is it? It's the responsibility of the legal aid authorities. I have appointed 400 panel lawyers. I have appointed 400 paralegal volunteers. It's my responsibility to see that they're doing their job properly. Otherwise, I have no business to be there. Because I'm not doing my job properly, or because I think that, you know, even if I do my job properly, nothing is going to happen. So therefore, I say, forget it, you know. Why should I waste my time?
Right.
That, I think, is the crux of the problem when we are talking about pre-trial issues, you know. That management is important. Implementation, the schemes are good. The implementation is important.
Right.
It is not being done.
And of course, there's a constitutional conversation to be had on the standard that is set for whether you have suffered as a result of not having access to legal representation or free legal representation. And I was hoping to go into that, but I will not in the interest of time. But I think the constitutional discourse around legal aid is rather poor. There's a lot of other conversation about legal aid, but just the constitutional analysis of what is allowed and how is it being allowed deserves a lot more attention. And I'll just go to my last question, and Aarti, if you can just come first in on it. Is this entire question of legal aid, you know, the sort of what I framed in my response, questions that I circulated, is it just a band-aid over a gushing wound? I mean, in that sense that there are such intrinsic fundamental problems with the criminal justice system, right? And there's only so much legal aid can do. And given those structural problems of torture, of illegal detention, of the infrastructure in our courts, the capacity of our judges, the capacity of our lawyers, right? You're setting up legal aid to fail, right? And in that sense, the failure of the legal aid system is inevitable. I mean, I'm sorry to sound so pessimistic, but the broader question I'm asking is legal aid then a criminal justice system problem rather than just being a legal aid problem in that sense, right? Does it suffer from much of what the criminal justice system suffers from?
No, I think that's being horribly pessimistic, actually. I'd like to think that these are systems that actually can be fixed. What it takes to fix them and the kind of initiative that has to be put into them needs to come from various different stakeholders. I think one of the largest stakeholders is the state. Another one, I do believe, is the judiciary. And I do think that if you spend a great deal of energy thinking about, I mean, for example, you know, this, you're talking about pre-trial legal aid. There is a incredibly well-oiled nexus between police stations and lawyers. We all know this, right? I mean, someone who is arrested in such and such police station's jurisdiction, the next thing you know, that accused has signed a wakalatnama, something that it has happened repeatedly, that case will come to me and I will go and see that, well, you know, accused has signed wakalatnama of another lawyer. That lawyer has not done anything, but there is really nothing that I can do. We have to start reimagining the way people access lawyers as well. I mean, everything can't come down to a legal aid problem as well, right? So it's different systems that are in place, and there does need to be a very, very thorough evaluation of how it is that these systems interact with each other.
Right.
We have no idea how these systems interact with each other right now. Who is this person who is going to the District Legal Services Authority saying, I require a lawyer? How have they found themselves there in the first place, right? They will not have, it's a very uniquely different person who will say that I will go to the state for a lawyer. They would have exhausted every possible other mechanism of trying to find, oh, my uncle's cousin is a lawyer in such and such location, call them, do they know somebody in Bangalore who will do, after all of those systems fail or they've had terrible experience with lawyers who've taken a lot of money from them and have not delivered at all, which is another very unchecked system on how a lawyer delivers and what a lawyer delivers in a case, and how many bar counsels or how seriously does bar counsel take its own misconduct proceedings, and you know that's there's no check on this, so it's a free pass, I feel, a lot of time. So now if we were to look at all of these things and say, okay, we want to strengthen how it is that people access legal aid, and if there is enough of a push to set up that infrastructure where lawyers will go in and spend a certain amount of time, it can be done on an entirely voluntary basis, that this is the infrastructure available to you, X, Y, Z will be available at these times of the day, very much like Justice Lokur has imagined, an actual physical infrastructure where lawyers work out of.
Chambers.
We have a system, we're sitting there, we're working, and if cases are allotted to us, we would be happy to do them. That is not how this system works. It's far too random, and you are leaving it up to total chance that somebody who goes to District Legal Service Authority is going to be appointed some terribly competent counsel. Right. So to that extent, it's the current state it's in, it does appear like it will continue to function in this in this manner unless some serious revival of how this system ought to work is.
Monica, let me end with flipping the question to you. That an uncompromising position, a constitutional position, an institutional position on legal aid, saying that it's just going to be uncompromising about the standards that are expected for legal representation, right? Can that fix some crucial aspects of the criminal justice system in terms of the various crisis points? That if you were uncompromising on that you get a lawyer, when you get it, and what kind of lawyering you get through the state, can it fix some really difficult problems in the criminal justice system? Or
see, it could fix procedural problems. Right. It will definitely fix procedural problems. but it's not going to fix the substantive problems. And those are also there, you know. How do you define a crime? How do you define who gets arrested? So those are issues that won't get fixed by legal aid, but they may get reduced by legal aid. Mm. Substantive questions of what exactly, how do we look at crime, how do we look at criminal law, but a robust criminal legal aid system could probably take it further and constitutionally challenge those also. Yeah. So at that level, yes, it would definitely help, but...
Right. So we'll end this discussion here, and I'm sure many of you have many questions and clarifications to seek. Yeah, so no, we'll have about 10 minutes to 8, but we'll just extend it by another 10 and go on till 10 minutes past 8. If we have any questions, please do raise your hands, and if when called on, please give us your name and your affiliation if you want to. But please do keep the questions or statements brief, please, so that we can get in as many questions. Sorry? Oh, right. Can we just start with you, sir? And can you just wait for the mic, please, to come to you?
Thank you very much for giving me the first chance. My question is very brief. There are some unproportionally high attention of legal aid to certain type of criminals when others are really, really in need of legal aid. Why it is like this? Why is it deserving? Thank you.
Okay, so I'll leave that question. I'll keep that question. You can answer that, who wants to.
Yes, sir.
Sorry, can you just wait till I call you on, please, to give you the question? Yeah. Can you just wait for the mic, please? And please give us your name and... thank you, sir.
Hi, I'm Trisha. I'm an advocate practicing in Bangalore. This is just a common sense. We were wondering if there's someone who could, you know, spearhead the legal aid system and kind of, play the head of it. I was wondering if designated senior counsels could step in to play any role here, not because I think... that they may do well, but only because I think they owe some kind of responsibility. You know, from the beginning, we have envisioned the role of a senior counsel as someone who has contributed to the bar, someone who holds some responsibility and not someone who is, you know, out there charging the exorbitant fees that they currently do. So is there any way to hold them responsible for the system, not say... invite them to responsibility, but hold them responsible and have them play a more proactive role in this whole thing.
Thanks, Trisha. Sir, please. Right? Sorry, we had... Sir, just very briefly, yeah.
Yes, sir. My name is Neeraj Shantkumar. I represent the Men Rights Association, and I come on behalf of Mitra. Women have got a lot of legal aids.
Sorry?
Women have a lot of legal aid. Even the WCD gives 3,000 per case. But men, we are suffering. Is there any way where men can be given some commission for legal aid and not at the court level, even before the pre-trial courts, can we get any legal aid like women get?
Thank you. Sorry, I'm just going to have responses to these three questions. I'll say what I understood as the first question, ask Vijay to take it. Do people accused of crime deserve legal aid or should we keep it for as Mr. Kamath said, there are more deserving people who need legal assistance.
So actually...
Yeah. More certain kinds of crimes. Right. Sorry, sir. Sorry. That he seems like certain criminals get more legal aid.
So actually, I think our experience has been that if somebody is taking legal aid, means his options are really next to zero. Those are the people who take legal aid. Most of the people take private lawyers. So when legal aid, I don't know of any cases where, you know, people who are arrested in serious offenses and have influence or money or family support, they don't go for legal aid. They have hire private lawyers. Legal aid is largely taken by people who have no other options. So I really don't think that, at least my experience doesn't bear out what you are saying.
Justice Lok, senior advocates, in your experience of these high courts and Supreme Court, do you, if you can, see, do you see senior advocates of the Supreme Court taking up Trisha on a suggestion and leading this fight?
Yeah, actually, you know, this suggestion had come many, many years ago in the 1980s. And that's when the legal aid thing was just about starting or taking off. And a large number of senior lawyers did volunteer. I mean, the court said that, you know, would you like to volunteer? And many of them did volunteer. And they perhaps did one case, you know, but then the whole thing petered out. And it's not been revived since then. So I think, you know, there is this initial enthusiasm, we'll do it, you know. But then when it actually comes to the crunch, it hasn't worked. And I don't see why it should work now.
So, Arthi, I'm going to put you on the spot and ask, sorry, I forgot your name.
Neeraj.
Yeah, Neeraj's question on women, let me just phrase that question. Women are identified as a group, as legal aid beneficiaries. Sorry. I'm trying to reduce the question to a question of principle, right? So why aren't men, I think, accused in certain kinds of offences, I suppose, automatically entitled to legal aid?
They would very easily get legal aid if they were to approach the District Legal Services Authority if they can't afford to hire a lawyer to defend them. The fact that there is a Department of Women and Child Development, as far as I know, the Department of Women and Child Development does not grant legal aid.
Sir, please. Let's have some rules clear. When you ask the question, nobody interrupted you. So when they are replying, you might be happy, you might be unhappy, but that's just life, right?
That when you go to either the State Women's Commission or you go to the Department of Women and Child Development and meet either the secretary or the member secretary, and there is a specific legal problem you have, they will either put you onto a lawyer who is on their panel whom they consult, or they would direct you to the District Legal Services Authority. Now, if we are getting into the question of why women stand in a special place with respect to access to legal aid, that would be a very long answer for me to give, because we have certain structural issues with the way women are able to access legal rights in the first place. So it's a question of equity and whether it is that easy for a woman to step out of her home to access legal aid as easily as it is societally, and that entire structure of negotiating whether a case should end up in court and the struggles that women face to actually bring a case to court, irrespective of the type of case that it is. I think, however, that is not the question that Mr. Shantakumar wants to ask. I think the question that he's asking is, why are there so many false 498A cases being filed? And how come husbands do not have a... Is that not the question? Then I'm fine.
Right. Okay. Great. So, we'll take... Sure.
We can come back to this question when a time comes when patriarchy is gone.
Right. Okay. Right. Can we have the lady at the back, please? Both of you, and you as well. Can we just have the lady at the back first, please?
ಕನ್ನಡ
ಹೇಳಿ.
ಈಗ ಎಲ್ಲ ಡಿಪೆಂಡ್ ಆಗಿರೋದು ದುಡ್ಡಿನ ಮೇಲೆ.
ಮ್ಯಾಮ್ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಹೆಸರು?
ನನ್ನ ಹೆಸರು ರೇಣುಕಾ ದೇವಿ ದೇಶಪಾಂಡೆ. ನಾನು ಸೋಷಿಯಲ್ ಸರ್ವಿಸನ್ನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೀನಿ, ಲಾಯರ್ ಆಗಿನೂ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ, ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡಲ್ಲೂ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದೀನಿ. ಬಟ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕೇಸ್ಗಳು ಡಿಪೆಂಡ್ ಆಗಿರೋದು ಯಾವುದೇ ಲಾಯರ್ ದುಡ್ಡಿನ ಸಲುವಾಗಿ. ಆದರೆ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡಲ್ಲಿ ಕೊಡೋದು ಭಾಳ ಕಡಿಮೆ, ಅದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಅದೇನಾಗ್ತದೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಫೇಲ್ಯೂರ್ ಆಗ್ತದೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ನೀವು ಒಂದು ಒಳ್ಳೆಯ ನೀವು ಸ್ಯಾಲ್ರಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿಟ್ಟರೆ ಸೀನಿಯರ್ಸು ಕೇಸ್ ಮಾಡೋದು ಸೀನಿಯರ್ಸ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ, ಜೂನಿಯರ್ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಬರೋದೆಲ್ಲ ವಿತ್ ಇನ್ 3 ಇಯರ್ಸ್ ಒಳಗೆ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ, ಅವ್ರು ಯಾವುದು ಟ್ರಯಲ್ ಗೊತ್ತಿರೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಏನು ಗೊತ್ತಿರೋದಿಲ್ಲ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಒಂದು ಸ್ಟೇಜ್ ಕ್ಯಾಟಗರಿ ವೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ, ಕ್ಯಾಟಗರಿ ವೈಸ್ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಜೂನಿಯರ್ ಮಾಡೋ ಕೆಲಸ ಜೂನಿಯರ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ, ಸೀನಿಯರ್ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡೋದು. ಇದು ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡಿಂದ ನೀವು ಸ್ಯಾಲ್ರಿನೇ ಕೊಟ್ಟರೆ, ಈಗ ನಾವು ಸೆಂಟ್ರಲ್ ಜೈಲಿಗೆ ಹೋದರೆ ನಾವು 200 ರುಪೀಸ್ ಖರ್ಚು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು, ಅದು ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಬಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಹೋದರೆ. ಓಲ್ವಾ ಬಸ್ಸಿಗೆ ಹೋದರೆ 300 ಖರ್ಚು ಮಾಡಬೇಕು. ಇದು ನಾವೇ ಮೊದಲೇ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋಗಿ ಮತ್ತೆ ತಿರ್ಗಾ ಬರಬೇಕು, ಅದು ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅವ್ರು ಕೊಡೋದು ಯಾವಾಗೋ. ಇದಾದರೆ ಈಗ ಅವರು ಲೈವ್ಲಿಹುಡ್ ದಿನ ನೀವು ಏನು ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ, ಲೇಬರ್ಗೆ ಮಂತ್ಲಿ ಇನ್ಕಮ್ 15,000 ಮಿನಿಮಮ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಇದು ಸೆಂಟ್ರಲ್ ಗೌರ್ಮೆಂಟ್. ಬಟ್ ಲಾಯರ್ಸ್ ಆಗಿ ನಾವು ಏನು ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಏನು ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಸಿಗ್ತದೆ? ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಒಂದು ಮಂತ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಸ್ಯಾಲ್ರಿ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಅವ್ರು ಎಂಥವ್ರಾದರೂ ಕೇಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ. ಈಗ ಈಗೆಲ್ಲ ಪ್ರೈವೇಟ್ ಹೋಗ್ತೀವಿ, ಈಗ 60,000 ಕೊಡ್ತೀನಿ ಅಂದರೆ ನಾನು ಹೋಗೇ ಹೋಗ್ತೀನಿ ಅಲ್ಲಿ, ನಾನು ಬೇಡ ಅನ್ನೋಂಗಿಲ್ಲ. ಅದೇ ಥರ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವು ಏನಾದರೂ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡರ್ಡ್ ಮಿನಿಮಮ್ ಅಮೌಂಟ್ ಮಾಡಿದರೆ ಯಾರಾದರೂ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಬಂದೇ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ, ಕೇಸ್ ಮಾಡೇ ಮಾಡ್ತಾರೆ. ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಮೈ ಒಪಿನಿಯನ್. ಒಂದು ಮಹಿಳೆ ಯಾವಾಗ ವಿಕ್ಟಿಮ್
ಇನ್ನೋರ್ಗೂ ಚಾನ್ಸ್ ಕೊಡಬೇಕು, ಅದಕ್ಕೆ
ಮಹಿಳೆಯರಿಗೆ ವಿಕ್ಟಿಮ್ ಇರೋದ್ರಿಂದ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡ್ ಮಹಿಳೆಯರಿಗೆ ಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆಲ್ ವಿಕ್ಟಿಮ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ವುಮೆನ್. ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡ್ ಸಿಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಅವ್ರಿಗೆ ಕೊಡಬೇಕು ಅನ್ನೋದು ಒಂದು ಉದ್ದೇಶ. ಓಕೆ, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ದ ಕಾಮೆಂಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ರಿಯಲಿ ದ ಕ್ವೆಶ್ಚನ್ ಇಸ್ ದಟ್ ದೆರ್ ಇಸ್ ನೋ ಫಿಕ್ಸ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಯಾಲರಿ ದಟ್ ಲಾಯರ್ಸ್ ಶಿ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ವರ್ಕ್ಡ್ ಆನ್ ಆಸ್ ಅ ಲೀಗಲ್ ಏಡ್ ಲಾಯರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೆರ್ ಇಸ್ಂಟ್ ಅ ಫಿಕ್ಸ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಯಾಲರಿ ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಪೇಡ್. ಅಂಡ್ ಸೋ ಇಫ್ ಯು ವಾಂಟ್ ಮೀ ಟು ವಿಸಿಟ್ ಅನ್ ಅಂಡರ್ ಟ್ರಯಲ್ ಇನ್ ಜೇಲ್ ವಿಚ್ ಐ ಮೇ ನೀಡ್ ಟು ಡೂ, ದೆನ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಟೇಕ್ ಅ ಬಸ್ that cost me 200 rupees to reach central jail, and that cost comes out of, I don't know when that amount is going to be released. That's one thing. The second thing is that all, in her view, a lot of legal aid lawyers who come in are lawyers who've just enrolled between 3 or 4 years at the bar. They don't, in her view, know anything, and as a result of which the quality of lawyering is very poor. So is there a system by which you could have different grades of lawyers depending on how complex a case is being allotted? That's one. And two, if there's a fixed salary that you pay to a legal aid lawyer and then allot them how many ever cases, and if that salary is good enough, I'd rather, I mean, she's saying that I would rather work for, say, 50,000 rupees a month and do as many cases as are allotted to me than depend on this amount being released per case or per hearing or not. Broadly,
right.
That's
the right. Ma'am, please.
Hi, good evening. My name is Sindhu. I am a lawyer practicing in Bangalore. Regarding the institutionalization of legal aid and the functioning of NALSA and other legal aid authorities over the country, Justice Lokur was saying, make it run like a law firm. Would it help control the quality and communication if the legal aid authority was itself responsible for developing strategy and allotting specific tasks only to lawyers, rather than giving the entire case to one advocate and expecting him to use his diligence or her diligence and run the entire case the way they would run had it been a private client? Since the client has come to the legal aid for service, shouldn't the legal aid be responsible for formulating a strategy and telling and asking them to go about the case in a certain manner, and also be responsible for advising the client substantially rather than just pointing them, acting as a broker and pointing them to one particular lawyer? Would that serve the part of the legal aid's responsibility?
It's not been tried out. A salary is given. But there have been complaints that the person has not been doing anything at all, you know, and he's just getting a salary for no rhyme or reason. That's why the other system was followed, that if you go to jail, you know, you will get 700 rupees or 900 rupees or whatever the figure is, plus expenses, you know. So if you're taking a taxi, for example, to go to Tihar jail, you will get the taxi fare. If you have to, because of traffic or something, you know, you have to have lunch outside, it'll be paid, right? So again, if you come back to this law firm business, you know, the person who's in charge of the legal aid center must make sure that the payment is made immediately. You know, the moment the bill is given, you make it immediately. And in fact, we did that in the Supreme Court. You know, the earlier checks used to be given and all that. But then when the lawyer would go appear in the case, and in the evening he would tell the member secretary that I have appeared in this case, whatever the fee was, it was being transferred to him through banking channels electronically. You know, so these things can be done. You know, it's not something impossible that you have to wait for 2 months to get your money. It can be done.
You respond to this question?
No, not respond. I just want to say that if this was the system, it would really help. Right. Because currently the situation is far different. In Delhi, is some kind of an island of excellence is what I can say. Even to get bail, they're supposed to get $500 for a bail application. They'll get the money after the trial is over. So they'll file the bail application now, for which they'll get 500 rupees, which they will get when the trial gets over.
Monica, I'm going to come to you as a teacher on the question of mandatory service, but Aarti, first to you on the legal strategy by the legal aid authority. As if you're operating as a law firm, we sit and decide what we're going to do in each of these cases, and the lawyer just executes the strategy.
No. The structure of the member secretary of legal service authority or other people who serve as administrative functionaries in the legal services authority may or may not, and this is not a question of their administrative capabilities. They could be extraordinarily good administrators in terms of how the legal service authority is functioning. They may or may not be lawyers to be able to devise a strategy. That's one thing. The second thing is that there are multiple strategies in cases that change from time to time. It's not that you sit at one point of time and decide this is what I'm going to do in a case and you hold on to that. That strategy will evolve, change, develop. If we're looking specifically at criminal justice work and appearing for accused, that changes depending on how witnesses have deposed, what kind of cross-examination you have chosen. It does not in that sense work like a law firm. That is not what I was suggesting when Justice Lokur proposed that model. I'm not saying that we all sit together and strategize a case. I'm actually saying that there is a building. It has infrastructure. These lawyers are available from this time to this time. A case is allotted to a particular lawyer, and when it is allotted to that lawyer starts working on that particular brief. So I would not go with handing legal services authority and the people who run the legal services authority to decide on how cases are litigated, because they may or may not be lawyers who have ever gone into a court or know how a case is litigated. So that you want to leave up to the lawyer to whom the matter has been given.
Monica, mandatory legal aid service for some elite students from the NLUs, or how is that going to go down, right?
Actually, before that, I'd like to answer, that previous question. I think the question was actually not so much about legal strategy as about accountability and monitoring. And I feel that, yes, it is very important that legal aid lawyers be held accountable for whatever they're doing or they're not doing. And the legal services authority, those who are heading it or those who are, a part of that structure, should actually hold them accountable. And if judges are heading it, they definitely have some experience. At least in the cases that they know are complicated and complex, there should be some amount of hand-holding if required. So you need not design strategy for each case, but where required, where a legal aid lawyer comes and says, I'm completely at sea, I don't know what to do, tomorrow is my cross-examination, I don't know how to go about it, then some amount of, if the legal services authority invested more than just appointing a lawyer, then it would be great. His question, when I was listening to it, I also studied in Government Law College and paid 200 rupees a year as fees. But I was just thinking that, we can be held accountable, but the National Law University people who spend 5 lakhs and 6 lakhs, then we're just letting them off the hook. So
right.
I'm not...
There's a serious conversation there on the cost of legal education. Right, and how that plays out And I think a serious conversation to be had on this is what is the state of legal aid clinics in law schools, right? Be it any of the premier ones, or I don't know why they keep calling them premier ones, but anyway. Or even if it's a law faculty or a law department, what is happening to legal aid in law colleges and law schools? And I think it's a very, very dismal picture, right? Instead of spending tons of broadband bandwidth on which is the best law school and who gets the highest corporate salaries, if law colleges and law schools is to spend some more time on analyzing what real impact they're making, I think we'd be better off. So in that sense, the first step towards that, or even any step towards that, would be to first look at what are legal aid clinics doing in law schools. And I think the answer is going to be not much, right? I have time for two questions, and I'll take one here.
Compared to other...
Name.
My name is Rajesh.
Yeah.
Compared to other modes of trying to address this problem, there seems to be a disproportionately low technological imagination. It sounds like a lot of these problems could be solved technologically. Communication between councils and under trials. I know it can't be an SMS because prisoners don't have cell phones, but you know, some. It seems like everything, a lot of the problems that are being spoken of here are technologically addressable. So I want to also frame it in the larger question of, is the judicial system in India generally a bit anti-diluvian and Luddite, anti-technology?
Right. Okay, take the last question from absolute corner there, right?
So my name is Aniket, and my question is more, so assuming that the standard and quality of legal aid is vastly improved, but once that person actually gets to court, what can be done about certain institutional concerns about the judiciary being geared against people from poor socioeconomic conditions, the minorities, the people from SCST communities? So what can actually be done about these judicial biases that persist generationally?
Thank you, Aniket. Just Loku, do you want to take the, given your work with the e-committee of the Supreme Court, do you want to take the question on technology? Yeah.
You know, so far as this technology thing is concerned, from the e-committee, we asked all these state legal services authorities if they need computers, printers, and all that. And what we were told was that every state legal services authority is fully equipped with, computers and printers. So they didn't want any. We had budgeted definitely for the district legal services authorities and for the taluka legal services authorities. So we gave the money to the state legal services authorities and said, you buy the computers, you buy the printers, whatever you require. Some of them did buy, some of them, are still in the process of buying and so on. We had also talked to NALSA, if you want to develop a software, because NALSA has got the money, if you want to develop a software for your needs, you can do that. If you want the e-committee to do it, e-committee will also do it. There was no, satisfactory response from NALSA or from the State Legal Services Authority. So on our own, in the CIS, that is a case information system, which is given to all the district courts, we have developed, we have embedded a program for these lokadalats, right? Because apart from lokadalats, there are many other things, but then somebody has to take the ownership for those other schemes. Nobody really has taken over those, the state legal services authorities have not done it, and NALSA has also not done it. So really, from our side, we gave them whatever they wanted, but subsequent steps have to be taken by them. Either they want the committee to do it or they do it. There's no response. There are just two things that I just want to say. You know, one is that, you know, there is a lot of money that is available with NALSA. In fact, sometime back, one or two years ago, the government said that, you know, we're going to reduce your funds by 50% because you're not spending the money. And, you know, then they were told that, no, we have these plans and all that, and you give us some money. And I think 400 crores was asked. The budget used to be 120 crores. They wanted to reduce it to 60 crores or 80 crores. 400 crores was asked and 400 crores was given. Right? So there is no shortage of money, you know. That's one. The second thing I was just asking the professor, you know, there are a lot of problems, you know. We've heard a lot of problems. I think you should bring it to the notice of the, you know, judge who's in charge of the State Legal Services Authority or to the Chief Justice, that these are these problems, you know, we need to look at it. And you will get a response. I'll tell you again, you know, coming back to this computerization thing, in Delhi, when we started the computerization process, the district judge, we had these dot matrix printers. And the district judge came to me and he said, you know, my budget is only 300 rupees and this thing costs 350 rupees. So how if the printer goes out because the, you know, when that gets spoiled, you know, I have to go through a long process just because it costs more than 300 rupees. So I told the Chief Justice, I said, listen, 300 rupees for a district judge is nothing. You know, and my suggestion was that why don't you make it 5,000 rupees a month? The Chief Justice said, why 5,000? Let's make it 10,000. You know, so he had the discretion, the district judge had the discretion to spend 10,000 rupees. That figure has now gone up to about 50,000 rupees or whatever it is. So, you know, if you bring these things to the notice of the Chief Justice, a solution can be found. You know, so that many of these things, you know, non-payment or delayed payment, you know, or money not being given for transport and all this, once I think it is brought to the notice, once it is brought to the notice of the Chief Justice, it can be found, you know, and I think we also need to, you know, be a little more proactive in this.
Right.
And bring it to the notice of the authorities.
And I think just adding on to Justice Loku's response, I think just a conversation on this is even the just providing computer infrastructure, right? Computers, printers, ensuring there is enough electricity in the district courts that these computers can run, right? The conversation on technology is somewhere at that stage, right? And therefore, in terms of looking at higher level innovative technological solutions, right, is a very, very significant challenge, right? And Monica, if we can end with a response to Aniket. Aniket's question on, we could do all of this and we could come up with a brilliant legal aid system, but what are we going to do about inherent biases within the criminal justice system?
I wish I had the answer. I really wish I had the answer. But yeah, that is, you know, I really... No, I think you fight. You fight with everything that you know and learn and progressively learn and learn from colleagues and learn from other lawyers around you, and you channelize all of that into how you build a case for your client. There is really no, there's no shortcut to that. There is no, it doesn't get easier or more difficult. And of course, then there are some strategies that you anyway deploy. You will not move a bail application before a particular high court judge. You'll wait for that roster to change. You do these things. We all do it. It's not, and there's nothing wrong with doing it. This is not some underhand thing that is happening or whatever. You gauge, you study the system, you realize how it works. You spend a lot of time thinking about what type of case succeeds in what circumstances, and you will lose despite all of this work. But there is no other way to do it. And you do it every single day. If that is your job, and if you decide to litigate on either side of this, whether it's whether it's criminal law, whether it's civil law, whatever type of law it is that you're practicing, there is no other way to do this. And you have to keep at it. And it can get frustrating. It does get tiring or whatever it is. Hopefully you're in the company of other people who do similar types of work. There are networks now in the country that have certain types of lawyers doing particular types of cases that are that pose very difficult challenges for their clients. You plug into those and you draw a certain sort of energy from it, and you learn tremendously. You essentially you never stop learning. That is perhaps the only way in which you will make some headway in this, I think.
Absolutely.
There's a lawyer once who had told me that, you know, there are three types of law in this country.
Three types of law?
Yeah, there is statute law, there is case law, and there is face law. So we move according to that.
So, Justice Lokur, was it you who wrote that legal aid for the poor does not mean poor legal aid? Right. So, I think that captures much of the discussion, right? That just because you're providing legal aid for the poor doesn't mean that the quality can, that you're just providing it is the answer, right? There has to be a serious conversation about it. And I just leave, especially the students here, with a message in terms of just a question about when the state is investing in you, right? Even the cost of education at any of the law colleges or the law schools costs a lot more than what students are paying. There, I think, at least when you're in law school, you have an obligation to the people of this country who are funding your education, that you do the best you can, right? Irrespective of whether you might going to become a lawyer for Amar Chand or Khaitan or anybody else that you want to become a lawyer for, or Herbert Smith, right? At least during your time in law school, right? You try and give back to the people who are facilitating and funding your education, right? And the people of this country. And really an appeal to the law students and other students to get involved in the legal aid mechanisms that the state has brought about and try and improve it, right? And as Aarti said, the least we can do is fight, right? Thank you very much and have a good evening.